Dis mar ib galéir agus fáilte roimh go dtín bad chréile seo ina mé míad na a plé cuasaí chum an Lúclas Gael ó 1983. Líana ar bhuaig Cáil Chuinnig an trá agus an chréamh don darbh líon as a chéile ina máint. Inar bhuaig á clia ceannas na cluichí ceannais peile ba chunspóidí riamh. Agus chuige sin tá an bheirt haptaí na gcoinge ansa Liam Fenley, Cáil Chuinnig, Tommy Drum á clia agus an craoltóir sport Ger Canning tá fáilte roimh galéir.
Gur míle maith agat a fíl.
So, Liam, let's start with you. Kilkenny had already done the double back in 1982, so heading back into 1983, you were the team that was at the very top of your game. What were the expectations heading into that championship?
Well, I suppose 82, we were in Division 2, and we came out of Division 2 along with Wexford, and we both ended up in the league final, and we won it. And then we got through to the list of final again. Offaly was probably one of the hardest games I've ever, well, the second hardest game I've ever played, actually. 83 was probably the hardest game I've ever played against them. And Offaly were very good at the time after winning the All-Ireland in 81, so we knew what we were up against. And we got through that one, and then going into the final, Cork were absolute favourites, and we kind of had a fairly physically strong team, and we just, on the day, things went our way, and we managed to win. So coming into 83, we knew Cork were still going to be around, and we knew Offaly were still going to be around, so we knew what we were up against. But naturally enough, we were probably more in the limelight now, so it was going to be more difficult to win. But we won the league, and then naturally enough, we got to the final of the hurling, and we got there as well. So there were two great years.
And we'll have a great chance to look back at the matches in question. Tommy, for yourselves in Dublin, I was looking back over the team that started that All-Ireland final. Very little experience in that. I think you had three All-Ireland winners from the 70s teams, yourself among them, Brian Mullins and Anton O'Toole. But a lot of under-21s, a lot of younger players coming through. So, like, can I suggest that there wasn't the same level of expectation in Dublin for that year?
You're right. In fact, if you go back to 1978 and 79, interesting enough, John O'Leary and Ciarán Duff and Barney Rock would have been on the losing All-Ireland minor team in 78 and they would have been on the winning team in 79. And I have to say, you know, they were a massive addition to our team. And with Anton, the late Anton indeed, and Brian, and I suppose Mick Holden to a lesser extent, we did have a good backbone, and that stood to us.
Okay. Okay. Ger, Mother led the Hale Hain. Vitas a Dirac Tosna and a Rev Marcrail Thor, Sport le RTE, Mihal O'Hare, Egdridan le Dera Array, Agus Tosa and Fargarev, size on hot seat of an Achtlesh Bader.
Well, the list of completion. The Hussing May le RTE TV in 88. So, Shahan Karub Liam Dosa, the Marcrail Thor, Leshon Sunday game. Octo here and up the door was Octo 3. Agus, you know, be bunus anahanaver fados, Chimera, you know, anahanaver fados.
We can agree in. Liam, let's start with the matches. So we're going to have a look now at the at that Leinster final that you mentioned, the game against Offaly. Now, before we talk about the 83 final, I want to ask you about an incident that happened towards the tail end of the 82 final. We don't have the clip, unfortunately, but just to remind people at home, so you were bearing down on goal. The Damian Martin, the Offaly goalie, tries to let the ball run wide. There's a question as to whether it does or doesn't run wide, but you manage to scoop the ball in. Matt Ruth is waiting in front of an empty goal and he piles it into the net for an important score. Liam, was that ball gone wide enough for you?
Well, Mihal O'Hare said it was gone wide, so you have to believe Mihal. Who would be going to believe me? No, it was something that Damian had a habit of doing. When the ball was coming into the ground, he had a habit of going out and letting on to pull on it, and then most people would more or less stop, but I just happened to keep going, and the ball bounced up, and I flicked it back, I think, under my legs, and it came to Matt, and Matt often spoke about it later. He wasn't actually going to hit the ball, because he thought it was wide as well, so eventually he decided that he'd poke it into the net, but it barely went in by the post, but it probably turned that game, yeah, because that game was on a knife edge up to then, and Offaly, as I say, were in top form at the time, and that was a hell of a game of hurling.
And you've already mentioned how hard the 83 battle was as well. So Offaly obviously came in with a little edge into that final, did they?
Because Offaly were very, disappointed after 82 because they felt they could have won that game. And 83 was a different game. I remember after about 50 minutes, it was only something like 9 or 10 pints each. And it was absolutely bang all day. They had got their matchups fairly right from the day and the people were following people around. And it was just very difficult to get a score, and they moved. Christie went corner forward, and they moved Eugene Cochran out to the corner, and it kind of left a bit of a gap in front of the goal. And they put Brendan Keeshan back in on me, who was on me all day, and we just happened to get a bouncing ball and turn him on. I gave it to Christy and Christy put it in the net. We ended up winning by 7 points, but the game itself, I was never as tired after the game. The following day, I was sore all over, and so was everyone. It was a hell of a game, and it probably prepared us for what was coming, because we'd beaten Wexford in the first round by, I think it was 5-13 to 3-15. Again, a hell of a game, a high-scoring game, a totally different type game. But Leinster at that period of time was very strong, where Munster, I suppose, was being controlled by Cork, and Munster wasn't as strong. I know that year Cork did draw with Limerick, but they beat Waterford pretty well in the semi-final, and they beat Galway fairly easy in the All-Ireland semi-final as well.
All right, okay, well, let's have a look at that game. So, Kailhuinig, agus Ifoili, agus Dushan of Urdus Nabutori, or Dirakishaki, Glehekanish Naher and Doishud of Winning Klehisha, Kailhuinig, agus Ifoili.
Chased out by Brendan Keeson, still Harry Ryan. He's now 20 metres out and he drops it over. Damien Martin is signalling that it had gone wide. Oh, that was a timely interception by the left half-back. This is Pat Delaney, the centre half-back. Look where he is. Oh, marvellous stop. Pat Delaney, the centre half-back, popping up in between. Cut off by Joe Hennessy. This is Liam Fennelly, Christian Heffernan inside, it had to be a goal, it just had to be a goal. In one sparkling moment. Christian Heffernan now. Christian Heffernan with the shot on the point. And it's all over. Kilkenny are still the Leinster champions and they go forward into the All-Ireland final now on September the 4th.
So it's going to be hard work now as you come towards the end of August.
Oh, it'll be hard work. An All-Ireland final ahead like is 3 weeks hard work and there's no question about that. So no matter who's in the All-Ireland final, let it be Galway or let it be Cork, there's no difference. There's two good teams left now.
Yeah, Liam Nolsky in there towards the end talking about his expectations for the final. He was a wonderful goalie. I think he was on course to win his 9th All-Ireland, if I'm not wrong, that year. When you compare Noel and the likes of Owen Murphy, who would you prefer now if you had your choice out of those two?
So look, different times. Noel was an absolute, really into the game. He was in training every night first and he'd be last to leave the place. And at the time, he was a bit of a leader as well as everything else. And he was well, you know, he was very experienced. So, Owen is a great goalkeeper at this stage and he's actually more or less playing the full back line as well as the goalkeeper. The goalkeeper at that time stayed back in his goal, he'd done his job, but now Owen is always marshalling the full back line. Two excellent keepers.
Yeah, Ger, Cadde de Hurum, for you shouldn't be Chadakar, not me in the Goni, Camperoddy, and the Vidder. Gluinta Egg Sula, but Ton Vertica, August Viski, and their house, Ta Murphy, Comaki, and the Darren.
The Viski in her house, August Ton the Buin Galair Egg Ski and Shin on the Run. Owen Murphy, Tana Vas, Gudyog, Ormsa, Owen Murphy, Countess na Coolbari is far at all going the Linga shot. Be alone Coolbari on a waha on a ganam shin, agus skin and a mask.
He can tigarev. Okay, bugamy the raggedy Coursey Pella and Tommy, your first game. So, all clear agus e foily, Iglihekanish line. So, awfully going really well, Tommy, in both football and hurling. Obviously, they were the incumbents. They'd won the All Ireland the previous year. They'd won the previous three Leinsters. Did you feel, though, that you know, the celebrating that they must have done through the winter of 82 might give you a chance heading into this one?
Yeah, well, obviously you'd hope, but, you know, after they lost the All-Ireland final, I think, in 81. And, you know, they were very hungry. So they were a really tough side, and Matt Connor probably at his best in those days. So we wouldn't have taken anything for granted. We wouldn't have assumed that they weren't top shape, to be honest with you. But definitely the team to beat and the team that we really struggled to beat over the previous years.
The game, I suppose everybody got a bit of a lift in terms of, say, underdogs that year because Cork had just beaten Kerry the previous week in the Munster final, completely against expectations. Would that have been a factor coming in to say, do you know what, if we get past Offaly, it's open season now for the rest of the championship because it'll all be about new teams at that stage?
Yeah, well, it's interesting you should say that we did play Cork in a friendly coming up to the game against Offaly and we were well beaten. We played them away. And so I think you're right. You know, you're always looking for an edge and something to motivate yourself in taking on any team. And certainly for us, we would have looked at you know, what was happening around us, and that was a big motivating factor, no doubt about it. And but for us, it was really us having to prove ourselves, and we haven't done that over the previous number of years.
Okay, so okay, if we're a new if we Kevin Heffernan and a gabointe show Marshin, August Knov drum in the forna or halohar egg and the whole garnish and the via grave fe hand. So if all the August Oclea, a glehekanish pella lion, August Shunchley, a harlish.
Drum gets a boot to it. Joe McNally here, and Joe McNally with the equaliser. Barney Rock still in possession, turns inside Liam Curran's, lobbing it forward. Anton O'Toole must score. Joe McNally. Joe McNally it was. Now Kieran Duff with the line ball. This is John Caffrey. John Caffrey, the scorer. Jim Ronayne. About 40 metres out. It's at a difficult right angle, but it's magnificent shooting by Barney Rock. The efforts of the steward. Dublin coming again. John Caffrey to Joe McNally. And that surely is the title.
Yeah, so that was it. Enough done, and a pretty comprehensive victory, I suppose, Tommy, you could say. There was a question, was there, about after the previous year, that in the Leinster final, had something been said to Kevin Heffernan that sort of gave him something extra to use heading into that match in 83 against Offaly?
Not that I recall. The thing I remember about the Offaly game was that one thing that Heffo tried to do was try and introduce something a little bit different to his teams. And in the 70s team, a big part of the 70s team would have been moving Tony Hannahoe at the centre-forward position, creating that space for the ball to be played along into Jimmy Keating. And then in the 83 team, it was really a question of John Caffrey being the third midfielder, just trying to do something a little bit different and use somebody who had a great engine to make himself available around the middle of the field. So that's my memory of the Offaly game, and trying to do something that might unnerve the opposition in some way.
Yeah, and that third midfielder, that was unusual, wasn't it, for the time? And it did seem to catch Offaly on the hop.
Yeah, and, you know, we used it again. Even though we had obviously shown our cards, we seemed to be able to get away with it because maybe it was such an untried formula.
Okay, it did. It worked that day for sure. Okay, well, we'll see in a little while how you got on in those All-Ireland semi-finals against Cork, those classic games. But Philemy the Horsey Amon, the Foyler, I guess, and Kid Kian the Clehi, Lachanish Naharan. So, Father V, Kalhunig at Fanachter Nabutori, in St. Glehekanish, who Kirkig Aig Erhalef.
The centre now, Steve Mahan now, Steve with this mighty puck of his, right up into the goal mouth. Kirk Cunningham lets it fall to goal! It's a goal! Joe Connolly out from, this is John Crowley. The Moscow Cahit coming through now, a shot, a goal! A goal for Cork! Long puck out. Jimmy Barry Murphy with the ball now. Lobbing ball across the goal mouth. And it is, it's a goal! Quickly, old Murphy, crashing it into the net there. A lovely centre that came from Jimmy Barry Murphy. Dermot McCurtain, John Fenton. Oh, what a lovely goal! Oh, one of the greatest goals of all time! This is when you're going to see in slow motion, but the slow motion won't even slow it down. Watch Jimmy Barry Murphy's stick as he sends this one to the net. Tom Cashman to take it.
the net coming the searching for the ball, and the referee has blown the final whistle. And so on the first Sunday of September, it will be All Ireland champions Kilkenny against last year's beaten finalists Cork.
So bua compor the commercial egg kirky in single hill like anishin because jur is talk of go after on the war in single hill and count honig er do spore and botoon egg kirky egg jur Cunningham Augustin Driachin egg Jimmy Barry egg through them the der in the himmer nak untuk the kirky go out the rob to itena or the tration botoon luishin con itena hurtish tax the agase of woken co compor the.
Well, the viewer are on Moher, the father, right, is the Rory Shaw. August Motherlish and Coolshin, oh, JBM. Is Stolem going to be on Coolest Far, a Gnohic She, Ria, Bishop of Topics on, a Driot Car to be on. The Diffriacti Bonusuka, Erevurn Erli, Sathligarev, Donal O'Grady and Ishmore, Lon Cooley, a Kirky, Ribishin and Vlian Ribishin, be Martin Doherty on. Now, be Martin Gahuntuk, be Mayor Skylish, Darlene Gale, August Vishin's Fornishin in the Shaktodi, after be Sheikh Taktawalia America in Octo Do, August Near Bakshid Lashin in Octo 3, Quisha Donal O'Grady Ishtak, be Ray Commons in Hekoma. So be Dini Nua a Takt Eremover, Conacomaran Shin Tomas Malkahi Kuramagos, Lad Og Eganam Shin, and Vlian Ribishin be Bainwur Erelehe Tony O'Sullivan, a Vierauser Fad. Nirev Clehkanish Mahage in Octo Do. So the be Diffriacti Lefoil, August Conicomariad in Octo 3, August we brew war or Corke Coma, the Vor Gakahorla on Vlian Rivishin.
So Liam, for ye then, ye were going to be playing, we mightn't talk about the final for a while yet, but I presume you were at that game or at least you saw it close up. You were there, were you?
No, we watched it on television.
You watched it on television, okay. So what did you make of their performance? And I suppose you must have been expecting Cork to be really gunning for you then later on, taking into account that they wouldn't like to be beaten twice in a row.
Yeah, look, it was natural enough. They were a star-studded team with all the big names, and naturally enough they were going to be upset from the year before. So, and we have to win in the All-Ireland and the league, so I always feel that when you're winning, you become weaker, really, than when you're losing. So, naturally enough, they had it, because they were beaten the year before, naturally enough, they were going to be really, really up for it. Naturally enough, in all Ireland, they're always going to be up for it, but the mindset was going to be very strong. And we knew straight away it's going to be a very, very difficult game.
All right, for sure. Okay, well, Anishka Kursi Pella Arishling, August and Chied Chian, the Chlehi Lachianish Naharan, August Gailev Gimmert, and I Dunang Owl, Sichansa.
Eamon Coughlin is the world champion 5,000 metres runner, and also this continual bubble of excitement that has absolutely captured the whole of Donegal. And the ball coming out on the wing there to Dolan Reid. And Tommy McDermott coming up too. Tommy McDermott getting it, and now a hand passing over, and this is Michael Carr. And Carr takes a kick, that's hit the upright. Goal! Here is Keeney is the scorer, number 15. Cody Kelly is after him, playing like the dandy that he is, but he can't get the ball in because it's scored by Michael Carr. And Michael, one of the best players on the Donegal team in my foot, was the scorer of that one. Nicely held by Richie Lee. Brian Talty. Brian O'Donnell. Richie Lee. And a shot that's high and over the bar, reducing the lead now to 2 points. It might be more. We're playing 2 minutes of injury time now, and the game is over. And Donegal's great effort has been foiled by the experience of Galway by one single point.
Tommy, looking at that game, I mean, Donegal definitely left that one behind them, didn't they?
Sure did. And it was a very talented side, I have to say, and it took a long time for them to come through after that, as we all know. I have to say the Galway team learnt a lot from it, I would say. And I would have known a lot of the Galway players in the college's days, you know. And that kind of gave me a good insight into the depth that they had as a team.
Sure. Okay. Well, look, at Shin Gailev Tried, Marshin Gideen Glehekanish, Aka K. Avec Low, in St. Glehe Lachanish Ella, Chas, Clea, Agus Kirkig, Erichela, Fuiho, and Chet Kennekeson, a Barkin Krokig.
Here they come now with an effort. A high ball by Kieran Duncan. That's the first score of the game. Mullins takes on the tackling. Referee waves on the play. John Cleary up now to John Allen. Allen takes a shot under pressure and a very nicely taken point there. Barney Rock and Jimmy Kerrigan going for it. Breaks to Jim Ronayne. Into Anton O'Toole. O'Toole shaking off one man, going through a shot. Dublin doing a lot of fisting down of the ball. Ray Hazley. Out now to Dave Barry. Up along the wing. Dennis Allen going after the ball. Dennis Allen with the ball. A goal! A goal by Dennis Allen, and what a goal!
An amazing finish, Tommy, to that particular game. You must have thought you were gone, but not for the first or the last time Barney Rock pops up with an important goal.
Yeah, like you look at the earlier movement there, Brian Mullins setting it up across the field. What the hell, Ray Hazley, is our cornerback, was doing with that position? I should have words with him for playing out of position. Then for him to see across the field and to see the opportunity as a cornerback to pick out somebody in that position and to get a goal. Like they say, goals win all Ireland's, and there's no doubt about it. Goals are hugely important because the swing in momentum that it can bring to a team. And certainly we were chasing that game right through. Cork, great team. Dinny Allen, two goals. Oh my God. You just give him half a yard and he's in. And it was great to see Anton O'Toole and Dinny, kind of, who would have been on their teams, both teams, for such a long time, having such a big influence at that time.
And in terms of a learning process and what the younger players on your team would have taken out of that really teak tough battle to prepare them for the couple of matches that lay ahead, how important was that, do you think?
Yeah, and because it was Cork, go back to what I said earlier on, I think Cork had beaten us 3-19-2-8 in Cork, right? So we were really fear of them. We knew what they could do given half a chance. But and our team had only been developing over the previous couple of years. We were putting people in different positions. I was at fullback playing against Cork and only moved into centre back really after that. And so the John Caffrey situation, I said we were playing with. So for us, it was a massive boost. And then, of course, to be asked to go out of Dublin, where we were used to playing games at that level, that was a whole other piece of history really for us.
Yeah, Cork insisted on that game being brought down to Páirc Uí because, of course, Croke Park was Dublin's home venue. Have we heard that one before?
Well, I have to tell you, my uncle Tom McSweeney was a steward in Croke Park. He's long gone. My mother as well, both of them from Limerick. And when we got down to Cork for the replay, I walked onto the pitch with the lads to have a look at the field. It was a beautiful sunny day. And who was standing in the middle of Porky Quay with my Uncle Tom McSweeney from Limerick? And I will never.
Yeah, well, the Dubs took over Porky Quay. The Black Rock End was called Hill 17, wasn't that right, that particular day?
It was like a soccer match in some ways because of the hand clapping and the atmosphere was incredible. Absolutely packed on such a sunny day. And that's the great thing about the GAA. I think the travelling crowds bring a whole other dimension, you know, wonderful.
Yeah. Before we move away from the Croke Park game down to Cork for the replay, Tommy, I want to just ask you, we saw a quick clip there at the start of a little bit of crowd trouble in the Hill. That was the Hill was a real tinderbox, wasn't it, at that particular period? For those couple of years, there was more or less unrestricted access into the Hill. There wasn't much done in terms of crowd control. Was that something that ye as players were worried about and that somebody, you know, it could have really kicked off? We're only a couple of years away from major incidents happening in England and on the continent. And how did you feel about what was going on?
Well, obviously, we'd have friends at the Hill, so you know a lot about us. And I don't think we were able to influence an awful lot about tackling it. The real problem, you might remember, was the final. You know, it was such a wet day and it was treacherous conditions underfoot. And how somebody wasn't seriously injured is beyond me. I know there's an awful lot of people went through a tough time. So it's a really good point and something that would be forgotten now by a lot of people because of how wonderful the Croke Park development is.
Yeah, agus chair, I mean, Vitosa, Hunamaitu, Denna Trochter, there are Clehe Canish in Europa, Kupla Blini, Staney, and Kian in the Rev, Liverpool, Ligimert, the Solomon, like Juventus, even though near Van Rudd talk, there could be on, but in Hazel, Vitosa Egg Hazel, so Connictus in the Ruddy Ahorla, like on Rev, Clehe, the Huid and Common Luke Glasgow, Egg Dolan, Throson, and Dolat, Marak, Gervartig, Park and Crokig, Ahorui, and a big Abuintish in the Park and Crokig.
Well, the cool name Mihol O'Hare, again, of Taggart, so Clehe Canish in 88.3, Don Tribloid of the Erkinokish Adiog, Agus, near Vina Picturia going air foul, Kupel is second, Lannan Clare Araik. Stolem Gorev doubt in Agne Nahu the Roshago Ni, Fui K. Kofather, because the Sfade Lord, Dollar Regle, Croke Park, so three in a Wilshe, Marba, Hiana Snide, a Gabuin to Shin, you know. Ryan Blint in action to be Bradford, Curramagos, be Tina in Bradford, it was for Quagish Shea, the near Val Boss on Shin, on Sunday Heisel, couple of Shankton in the action, and Vienna in Adiogokto, Quig, it was for Truconay, Dina Boss on Shin, be Fibana Ella on Coma, Agus Hog Utherosh, Common Lucas Goyle on Kinna, Gomacart, Rodeg in the Enafushin, Agus be Aho Goyle. Park and Croke Igeshtiko. Hog she on Kudismod the Fihabliana, Conan Rudgalera Kurigriak, at the Coffee Ayen of Shanna Stide of Ahe, Egabuintishin.
And this Tommy Kondolchiskiti Porky Queev, so Maradur Tommy and Son Law, all ingrained at the Nahimerchin, either Hurkig, Agus, or Clea, Agus Hamir Olive, Visor Lehagadorish today.
Cork have switched the defenders along with them. Anton O'Toole here. Kieran Duff now from the left wing. The shot from Kieran is about 25, 30 metres out. It's a point. Michael Creedon, imagine facing a penalty in these first early minutes. And it's in. Yes, Brian Mullins has made it. John O'Leary here facing Dave Barry. Remember, Dublin a bad one. Cork have got another. Even greater than if this game had gone back to Croke Park. Dublin again on the attack. Kieran Duff here. He's on his own. Mark Healy with him now. He's got it. This is Dave Barry, he's got it! Penalty number 12, you hit the goal! Kevin Kelly recovering fast. Anton gets it into his possession. And across, Barney Rock is there. Yes! It must be the goal! This is Tommy Conroy. Barney Rock runs into position. Joe McNally is inside! Oh yes, it's so easy, and it's all over. Dublin are in the All-Ireland final in 3 weeks' time, and the Dubs can't believe it.
So 43,000 in the sunshine, Tommy, and the Dublin contingent in particular, delighted with that. That was a lovely little step over there by Joe McNally. He was kind of capable of that kind of stuff. He never kind of looked to me to be absolutely fully fit, but he played the full, you know, whatever length of the game in all of the matches that he played. And he was one of these guys who was literally, he could come up with that moment of magic at any time.
Yeah, it's interesting. The late Kevin Heffernan, right? Another thing he would have done, Joe would have played in goal before, right? And look what Kevin did for the team and for his career. And so, yeah, he was a very physically strong individual. And like, he broke onto the scene at 19 years of age. So he was a massive addition to the team. And but the Cork experience was incredible. We'd never travelled really abroad for a game like that. So we had a team meeting in Blarney the night before. And that was a completely different experience. And the one thing I remember Heffernan did, he said to the team, just do what you'd normally do on a Saturday night. I think a couple of the guys probably thought and had a pint. Some of us stayed around the hotel, others went for a walk. But it was an incredible experience, I have to say. Credit to the GAA again, you know, to put a sporting event like that in place. And outside of Dublin, maybe you need to look at more of that now. If we've better stadium around the country, you know, that would be a good thing. And for us, it was... In many ways, when you look at the 83 final, which had such a negative tone, right? And for us, that was probably the highlight in many ways, because there was no side to it as such and no legacy as the final, unfortunately, did later on. So it was a real high point. And go back to Brian Mullins, he'd nearly been killed in a car crash in June 1980, just before the Leinster final against Offaly. And he had an absolutely magnificent game that day. You know, his distribution with left foot, with right foot, to take the penalty. And he hit Kieran Duff on the team and Barney Rock. Why the hell was he taking the penalty? And he puts it in off the corner, left corner. You know, crazy. And that's down to the late Kevin Heffernan as well, just making decisions, thinking outside the box.
And trusting the players. You mentioned the letting young fellas going out. I mean, I suppose that was the thing about Kevin Heffernan, wasn't it? That he was more than just a tactician. He mentally had to be able to appeal to, say, the older generation, like the three that had been involved in the 70s team. And then this, like, people who are way younger than them, he had to find a way to be able to figure out how to get these guys to tick as well.
Yeah, and they seemed to, like, you know, go back to 55, Ger Rice, the Dublin team should have won the All-Ireland in 55 and they were hammered by Kerry. That was a massive, massive blow to Heffernan, because he was had a stellar career at that time. And so we learned a huge amount about psychology. And he changed his approach between the 70s team and the 80s team. And he trusted us with a lot in the 80s and kind of pushed back onto Mullins, myself and Anton in terms of team meetings and all of that. So it was great to see how adaptable he was at that stage.
Okay. So Dublin through to the final, Marcin, and Naig na Gaelaba. Gáclithe fágtha a gcoinne le leart fúthu. Ach an chéad cean is ach cluiche cean is na hÉireann ina maint. So don dara blin as a chéile, Marcin, Cáil Chuinnigh agus Corcaigh a thug aig ar a chéile. Liam, before we look at the clips, so Cork were on 24 titles at this stage. Kilkenny were narrowing the gap and on 22. Mm-hmm. Pat Henderson was your manager at this particular time. And I suppose with all the talk about Brian Cody in modern times, justifiably so, we tend to forget about characters like Pat, who won three All-Irelands himself as a manager. He came in with Eddie Kerr, I think, in 79, wasn't it, as a co-manager. Mm-hmm. Straight off the back of being a player, into the manager's bib, wins an All-Ireland with Eddie Kerr. And then in 82 and 83, he wins them on his own, if you like, as manager. Just give us an idea of what he was like. And maybe, you know, should we be talking more about his achievements as a manager?
Yeah, he came in, as I said, at that time. And... Kilkenny had to go through a pretty bad spell, actually. We were beating the Kerry in Nolan Park in the league, and we had some bad results in Division 2, and we failed to get out of Division 2, I think, in 80, I think, well, or 81, wherever them years. So he took us over when we were in Division 2, and look, we had to put a team together, probably a lot of the older names, and then a few of the newer boys came into it as well. He was determination, unbelievable honesty. So that's what he demanded, really, is work rate, honesty, determination, which is probably no different from today. But the fitness levels today are actually enough are far better. But it wasn't that we were much into the fitness. It's just generally into the whole area, really. And the ball, the hurling and the ball were the main parts of training.
Okay, all right. Well, let's take a look. So, Eg Cluiche Cánaiseach na hÉireann in 1983. Agus níor a fhacar éachar idir Cáil Chuinnigh agus Corcaigh sa cheannsa.
This is John Buckley with the ball, and from way out the field, he sends a high one, and it's a good one. Well held in the centre of the field by John Buckley. He cuts it, the breeze catches it. Ball goes now to Harry Ryan across into the centre now, and Fred Cummins with the ball going through a shot. No, the shot is knocked down. He tries to get, and it is a goal! A goal for Kilkenny! The goal for Kilkenny is Dirk Cunningham came out for it. And there's the throw-in, the second half is on, and Kilkenny in the attack. Billy Fitzpatrick, Christy Heffernan. Ball breaks now, and it goes to Ger Fennelly, into Harry Ryan. Ryan trying to get through, and a shot, and a goal! A goal by Richie Powell! Cork back in the attack again, Bertie Oak-Murphy. Grabbed. Come on, that's the goal that Cork wanted! 5 minutes in which to save the game. Kilkenny have 5 minutes in which to hold on. Pat Hogan into the goal mouth. It is saved. It's a goal! It's a goal! It's a goal! And I think Sean O'Leary could be the one that got it. This is Billy Fitzpatrick now. Brian Murphy after him. Billy's shot is high from an impossible angle, and he has sent it over the bar. It's ball is out on the far side of the field. Referee has called for the ball, and Kilkenny are the champions. Kilkenny are the champions. They've weathered a rough Cork storm in the finish. When I say rough, a hard one. A Cork storm when they came back and threw everything at the Kilkenny men. But Kilkenny have completed the double-double. They have once again beaten Cork. 2-14 for Kilkenny. For Cork, 2 goals and 12. 2 points between them. Liam Fennelly joins his brother Ger as a captain of the Kilkenny winning All-Ireland team.
Liam, it was great to see the cup being lifted, I'm sure, there again to look back at that clip. But Kilkenny were 10 points up at one stage of that game. I'd say you were absolutely relieved to get through at the final analysis.
Yeah, we're very lucky that the people don't realise that we got 2 goals in a matter of a minute, the same as we did in 82. I got a touch on one just before halftime, and Richie Power got a goal just after halftime. And we played against the breeze. We played with the breeze in the first half, and Cork were probably on top for us in a lot of areas. But Billy Fitzpatrick that day had an absolutely magnificent day. And every time he touched the ball, he put it over the bar. So even though we were 10 points up at halftime, the goal put us, I think, 6 points up before halftime. But it was a damn close game compared to the scoreboard suggested. And I think we were very lucky that day. And just like the football final, the day was bad, the wind was blowing, the rain was howling. And I often wondered why all Ireland's were played in September, because it seemed to bring that kind of weather. Even though we were, as I say, it looks like comprehensible at one stage, we were very, very lucky in the end.
All right, who knows what sort of All-Ireland final we'll have in December, maybe this time around, we'll have to see. Ger, Madhula Kirkig, I say, if either the Wall Iron trainer or Cadi Yenimer, the Mechtusni's Fiora going to Chlehe Vechshashin Bwurta.
Yeah, we did more war a Kirkig, August Le Kirkig, on Vlienshin. We should yes, massa, no Octo Do early. Bilima kind on son fuin the cool, August the Varig the cool, Kirkig on Lawson, Kinta, Akvi Law Harleamta. Eg Tussie Kilquinig, on Leacus Mo, our father co, for Degulini Unchin, a Billy McKind Fui, Nomothohin, August Liam Fain in a Capti and Erouser Fad. August, I stoke a Gurra Fatius or Corky Griv Ray Fui Christy Heffernan, Rod the Bay Christy, on Leac Bavo via Coy Nocto Do, Akvi Cleherezon to Cuen, Eg Christy on Law Kiana, Livorshia Cooley in the wine, Akvi Baunilla Erinella in the Folk Ege, Eg Derin Obliana.
B. Kinta, agus Maradurt Liam and son, Billy Fitzpatrick. Degulín is done for Billy Fitzpatrick and Lois and Kuikain on Imert, agus Sor Law again. Okay, Tommy Taggadin Clehe Dernach, agus Tommy Bader, Attackadin Clehe is Mo Kainta, Avian and Vlian son, no Ain Vlian Elevator Harther and Amshin, Shin Clehe Canish, Pelin a hair in Edigotto 3, Nurhas O Clea, Erhilev, Fehemid and the Pictori or Deuce, agus and son, Clehemid, Padahorla.
This is the team itself, but as they pose there, here comes Galway! Now for Dublin. Pat O'Neill trying to keep it from getting away, but the Dublin man is penalised. Down also went Joe McNally. But Joe McNally being attended to as the game goes on. Bernie Rock takes his shot. It's a goal! It's a goal for Dublin! And quickly taken free there by Cornick. The rain absolutely lashing down. And heaven help the hill. But perhaps the sun will be back before long. Brian Mullins got his fist to that. And Brian Mullins got his fist to that too. I'm afraid Brian certainly misbehaved. And he's put off. Ball comes down to Tomás Tierney, and Tomás, there is a right rugby up down here in front of us, and the referee has sent the two of them off. Al Jolson would sing, there's a rainbow round my shoulder, but right now there's a rainbow round the hill. With players put off, there's a lot of gaps to be filled. John Caffrey, penalised, and now it looks as if somebody else is going off. Kieran Duff has apparently flattened somebody over there on the far, and he's been cut off. 11-4 in favour of Dublin. And this is Brian O'Donnell. He's going right through. He sends it across. It's a goal. It's a goal. But, yes, it's a goal. Here he comes. He lobs it out to the far side. And the game is over, and Dublin were the champions. And the crowd are absolutely streaming into the field. And so it's a Leinster double. Kilkenny and Hurling, Dublin in football. And there is Sam.
And like, we proved that, like, the papers were right again about the fullback. Like, they were very shaky, I thought.
Mick Holden, you're being sarcastic now. I'm glad I'm not a newspaper man.
I can't say anything yet, Mick, because I haven't really thought about it. I think that it's a great occasion for the young Dublin players. I think they proved today, beyond anywhere, that they don't need anybody carrying them. They carried themselves today, and I'm very disappointed that I wasn't there for the whole hour. That's the way it goes.
Well, I think, as Mick Holden said after the game, it might have been one of the worst games of all time, but by God, it was good to win it.
So, Tommy, that was you responding there at the very end. And I'm sure in the ecstasy of winning the All-Ireland, probably a lot of the incidents that happened during the game were missed by you and by several other players. But when you look back on the tape and you saw, say, in particular, the four sendings off, or the three incidents that led to four sendings off, what was your feeling at that point?
Mullen's greatest regret would be to swing out the way he did and connect with Brian, for sure. I think harmless enough incident between Tomás Tierney and Ray, they're a bit unlucky. You know, there was nothing in it, really. Tomás would be a good friend of mine now, after all these years. I mean, we meet up regularly. But certainly Kieran, you know, it looked really bad. It looked to reach out, you know, with his foot against Pat O'Neill's head. I mean, Pat would have said to Mags, Dully's wife, the following day, didn't connect, but it looked terrible, and by God, they pay a huge price for it. But I suppose I do remember, I haven't looked at that match for 25 years, and I looked at it the other night knowing I'd be talking to you today, and, you know, I love my rugby, and there's many rugby matches, it's hard to keep the ball standing, but even the Gaelic football that day was been blown off the ground. It was ridiculously tough conditions, but no excuse. It was a really tough game, I do remember when Brian was sent off, I was devastated for him. You know, go back to what I said earlier about the semi-final coming back after nearly being killed, and he was devastated to be sent off. And then you know, I found as well, playing in a team that's had one man sent off, generally the team raises its game. You do okay. Little did I realise we'd be down a couple more before the end of the middle of the second half. And against the breeze, it was really tough going. I remember Seamus McHugh, again, as a friend now, bursting through from left half back and could have got a goal, and that would have been it. So I think we were lucky in the second half. Galway missed a few scores, should have put away, and we did okay every time we managed to get up. But It was a tough game to watch all these years later.
And does it get any better, Tommy? Because, I mean, I suppose the incidents overshadowed the victory. Is it a game that kind of demeaned Gaelic football? Was it a shame and an embarrassment to Gaelic football, do you think?
Well, I think that was the conclusion from it. There's no doubt about it. If you walk around Croke Park, I think it's the only final they don't feature anywhere on the walk around Croke Park. I've noticed it over the years. I was forced to my pride at the end of the game, I have to say, with the effort that went in from the point of view of the guys who remained on the field. And they showed a huge amount of character. I think Pat Canavan was man of the match that day, and he just hoovered up so much ball. And so few chances in the second half. And Nansen managed to get some great possession. Joe could have had a goal, just took it over the bar against all the odds. So, yeah, it's the things you remember, I suppose, for me. There's only so much you can control as a player. So when things are happening like that around you, all you can do is try and step up to the plate yourself and hope that everybody on the field, are going to pull their weight and a bit more. So it was a strange, strange game, I have to say. And the aftermath was difficult as well. Over time, the jersey I'm wearing is the Dublin Galway jersey when we got together 25 years after that game. And I decided we raised €35,000. So we know All-Stars trips after the 83 final. We had to raise a few bob ourselves and went off to the Canaries. But when it came to 25 years to celebrate, I said, I've no interest in going abroad. Let's go down to Galway and spend a bit of time with them. I said it to Mullins, I suppose, because he was sent off. And the rest of the team agreed. We met Gay McManus down in Nace. He was a teacher down there. Put it to him. And then we hosted the Galway team in the Westport Hotel after a few days golf. Mullins had said to the president of the GAA at that time that we wouldn't turn up on the day of the 25-year anniversary unless Galway were invited. And as I understand, the losing semi-finalists were never invited. And we had this magnificent lunch in Croke Park that day. And you had the Dublin team of 50 years before with us and the Galway team. So, these guys from Galway are friends of mine now. And I love seeing them. And you talk about the goals that they can win and lose games. You remember the Mickey Sheehy goal in the 70s? Mm. And there's the Barney Rock goal. The kick out goes straight through him and he sticks in the back of the net. Such is the winning and losing of finals.
Okay, so it's good to hear that things have been mended and I suppose bridges have been mended. It's a pity that it took 25 years for it to happen, I suppose. Just on that... You mentioned Barney Rock and the goal. I mean, what were the conditions like? Because, to do that in the normal dry day would be pretty skillful. But to do it when there's a wind howling and it's lashing down and to have just... it was inches, wasn't it, that he had to play with to get the ball back over Pádraig Coyne's head?
Yeah, and it kind of leads me to a broader point. You're right. The conditions were absolutely ferocious. Gale force, wind and rain. But the thing about forwards and backs, and the game has changed a lot, as you probably noticed. When we got the ball as defenders, our biggest concern was to try and transfer the ball as quickly as we possibly could up the field. There was no defensive play as such that you see now. So take it from a forward's point of view, he's marking somebody and he's not alone as he got the win possession, kick the ball, he's got to get it between the posts as well. So to put a ball like that in the goal under sort of pressure with the conditions and obviously the day that was in it was an incredible achievement. And he was a great guy to score goals.
And that was the winning of the game. It was a 2-point game at the end, and that goal was obviously crucial. Ger, Nirhuigan press Bulgar Vlakli, a newer Hilef, Thracian Clihishan, Ger, Shunirian?
No, Nirhuig, August, Vian Kartico. Vianakuit kind of free John Goff, Kermagos, on Ray Tor, on Reveon Dolosike, Nito Lumsaka Rev, Tana Rielika Aon, Nifedele John Goff, Dolquigan Clihe, Canish, Lena Rielika Fane, Kahikshe, Nareal gata aone common Lucas Goel according Greek. Garrug Fionnuala cuicead punt on dá chunte in iachshin Blackley agus Galiv nearev common Lucas Goel sásta in éacar le caidám a himirha agus sásam slíon ar óg sé himirha on mo sportúil nach rivan agus comanishin dúirt John Goff in iachshin dá macchansa gairis go maidir go niachshin rud cana na kinni cana agus beidir níos moldi niachur Asan Bark. Near a van carti daraga eganam shin, near on shit sonestock, go count dem lean in the action, Gomaluklas Goel. Ak, be far away in a Peter Lee, August, Yarra, it's solemn, Kurikar Funri, Peter, fag Miasa, Teration Clay Shin. Clay Anat, Marador Tammy on shin, Ak Grana coma.
Yeah, for Kieran Duff gone out and Kion Bavasa, Gavi Dig, Blianum Long gone emmert. Kevin Heffernan obviously was your manager, and let's hear what he had to say directly after the game.
Kevin Heffernan, just beside you. Kevin, congratulations. I know before the game. I know before the game, we were talking here in this dressing room, you were worried about the conditions. They were even worse after the game started with that terrible rain.
Well, they were bad. I suppose it's an argument for playing the All-Ireland final in August rather than September.
Well, I know your friend Tony Hanahan feels very strongly about that.
Every year it's wet or it's windy, and after such a good summer, you know, there doesn't seem to be much justification in having it at the end of September, or near the end of September. And we're a week early this year.
That's right. But now, apart from that, though, a great victory for these young Dublin lads, because apart from three of them, they are a very young team.
Well, certainly it was a different final. It was a different day.
Well, you can say that in every way.
You know, in every way. It's very hard. I find it very hard to kind of make any constructive comment about how the match went. It was a jumble. It was confused. It was a very physical game, and the conditions didn't help.
Why do you think it was so physical? Was it the conditions, the wind and rain? I mean, that made it a lottery for a start.
I think that was part of it, but I think, you know, there was so much written about Dublin, and Galway decided that their best way, particularly playing against the wind, was to make it a physical game, and like we responded, we made it a physical game, and there you have it.
Not for quality, but nevertheless, the 21st All-Ireland title for Dublin.
21st All-Ireland, yeah.
Congratulations again, Kevin, and good luck. Tony Hannah.
Yeah, I suppose there was a lot of blame game, wasn't there, Tommy? You know, Galway blamed Dublin and Dublin blamed Galway. And I suppose it was a forgettable match in the final analysis, I think, wasn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I'd never participated in that, you know, myself, right? And I didn't do it at the time, and I won't do it now. You know, we're amateur players. We go out to represent our county as best we can. You know, it's a tough game. I wouldn't have any side for playing dirty football. Or sport, right? I regard myself as a sports person. And, you know, it was what it was. Not the toughest game I've ever played in, I would say, by a long shot. But it wasn't pretty, that's for sure. Anyway.
Okay, all right. Okay, Bokali, Gurmila Mahagrave has felling and so Erin Glora Tranona in Yov. Liam, before we leave it, I wouldn't mind just asking you just briefly, just the other side of your hurling life was obviously the Ballyhale connection. You played with you and six brothers, seven brothers in all, Fenleys played at a period in time. I mean, it was incredible. You won All Ireland's, you won county titles. A number of you played for Kilkenny at the same time together. It may never happen again, I suppose, because family sizes aren't as big nowadays as they were back in the day. But that must have been just a tremendous honour when you think back on all those matches that you would have played and soldiered together over time at Ballyhale and indeed Kilkenny.
Yeah, I suppose we're formed in 72 under the name Shamrocks, and we were known as Shamrocks all during that period of time, and the name has kind of moved on now to Ballyhale Shamrocks or Shamrogie Ballyhale, but the actual name is still the Shamrocks, and it's just something that happened over time. And look, it was a great period of time because the team that was there nearly won a county final in 75. And we then all, a lot of new players came on that were after playing under 12 or under 14 with the school team Ballyhale. And we started winning county finals in 78. And then it just from there on, then we won a club All Ireland in 81 against Finbarrs. And we were the first country team to do so. And it was a major, major honour. And it probably still remains as my greatest achievement to play that day. And my six brothers were playing with me as well. And I'll never forget that day. We just couldn't wait to get out on the field. It was one of these days in a dressing room where I'll never forget because everyone, there were nothing being said. We actually nearly broke the door down to get out, and we were just so up for it. I've only once ever after had a feeling like that before a game. But yeah, look, there were great times. There were great times in a small parish. And thank God then it moved. When we finished, the next generation came along, and now there's probably another generation. So I don't know what it is, but I myself put it down to the national school where everyone just, every day, all the boys bring in the hurdles. And someone told me recently, one day, 2 years ago or something like that, there were 28 young guys out training, and there were 30 between the classes, and the other two were injured. So it is just something that everybody does within the small parish, and that's where the skills are learned, and that's where the like the TG Reeds and all these players have come through from. It's just hurling is our life.
Yeah, it's just fantastic to hear. Tommy, final thoughts from you. 83 was a, I suppose, a watershed moment in lots of ways. Considering that the Dubs had won three in the 70s and then the one in 83, probably the expectation was there that as a young team you'd grow and you'd win more. And they didn't really. You had to wait till 95, and I think by that stage only John O'Leary was left in the team. Was that a surprise? And obviously it was a disappointment, but would you have said that that team in particular would have underachieved in subsequent years?
Yes, definitely, and would have gone to a number of All-Ireland finals, Mihal, and then just couldn't convert. And they must have had an enormous amount of experience across the teams from their minor days, having got to All-Ireland finals through 83, 84 finals, centenary final beaten by Kerry. And, you know, to get to finals and not win a final, it's probably the worst thing that you'll ever, if you've never won one, you've got to a final, you've lost. It's a horrible place to get to. So Dublin had to work really, really hard to win at the 95 final. So it hasn't been as long, obviously, from 95, a reasonable break up to 2011. And then I suppose they've had a wonderful run since. And it's great to watch them playing football. I really, really enjoy watching them playing football. And the current Kerry team are wonderful to watch.
Yeah, what a run the Dubs are on, right enough. Jaron Focal Dara na Clatsa, Nadig Octo Tree nor a Huinomi cheer air. The mask on the Bjogna Gokane, either fell agus a moind, Clihi Maha, Drochlihi, Kunspoidi, agus Orge Gilligwing Freshen. Blian Anahim Ulan or Ira Vian, Ohev Napella agus na Hamon, Naha?
Cinnte, nervim é brathnú siar ar na cluichí galéir don chláir seo. An rud a chuaigh go bhfeidhm go mór ar amsa, ná an caidán pelle a bhí á imirt in 83. Ná cluichí sin a chonaic mar an sanó cíanamh corcaigh agus blá clia. Bíadar ar ás ar fad na cluichí le ceannais sin, i bhfad níos fear ná an cluichí ceannais féin. Ach an pell, an stíl pelle, í cá oscailte, seanna stíl é tá isagam, tá sé ancora le Pell na hastroile ta a imar dinish. Ach níl gael ar bit ege, nu bioganin gael idar an pell a vian in 83 agus an stiff a ta gwing an ish.
All right, okay. Well, Gramago even threw to give us felling in so Eric Glor. No denig I daru dal an scale GAA gold tranona de downing ege fecha chun eise bag na scale tar fad pell a moint agus galorella le feshkintin sin Glor sin. Ach adisha, ma vwechas le Liam Fennelly le Tommy Drum agus leidir canning as felling and so ar a bad creal a seo, agus livsio sa waila as fe hefiach dystach, gydyn geid o rela, agus neidig ochtó cahar, slán tamad.